Please watch this short clip provided by Kent Hovind, in which Dr. Walt Brown explains the mechanics of the flood using the hydroplate theory. Then I will provide further information.
I think Walt Brown has the best theory on continental drift. Let me play this for you real quickly. This is the what's called the hydroplate theory by Dr. Brown. To me, it answers a lot of questions.
We can see on our planet 17 very strange features that can now be systematically explained as a result of a cataclysmic global flood whose waters erupted from subterranean chambers with an energy release exceeding the explosion of 10 billion hydrogen bombs. This explanation shows us just how rapidly major mountains formed. It explains the coal and oil deposits, rapid continental drift, why ocean floors have huge trenches and hundreds of canyons and volcanoes. It explains the formation of the layered strata and most of the fossil record, the so-called ice ages, and major land canyons, especially the Grand Canyon. The pre-flood Earth probably had one very large supercontinent containing lush vegetation, seas, rivers, and minor mountains. According to the hydroplate theory, the pre-flood Earth had a lot of subterranean water, about half of what is now in our oceans. This water was in interconnected chambers forming a thin spherical shell, about half a mile thick, perhaps 10 miles below the Earth's surface. Increasing pressure in the subterranean water chamber stretched the overlying crust just as a balloon stretches when the pressure inside increases. Failure in the crust began with a microscopic crack, which grew in both directions at about 3 miles per second. The crack, following the path of least resistance, encircled the globe in about 2 hours. As the crack raced around the Earth, the overlying crust opened up like a rip in a tightly stretched cloth. The subterranean water was under extreme pressure because of the weight of the 10 miles of rock pressing down on it. So the water exploded violently out of the rupture. Calculations show that all along this globe encircling crack, fountains of water jetted supersonically over 20 miles into the atmosphere. The spray from this enormous fountain produced torrential rains such as the Earth has never experienced before or after. The Bible states that all the fountains of the great deep burst open on one day. And it describes these events about 4,500 years ago, which we can now tie together scientifically in cause and effect order as the hydroplate theory. The fountains of the great deep and the expanding steam produced violent winds. Some of the water jetting high above the cold stratosphere froze into supercooled ice crystals and produced some massive ice domes, burying, suffocating, and instantly freezing many animals. The high-pressure fountains eroded the rock on both sides of the crack and even threw up the limey contents of many pre-flood seas. Huge volumes of sediments settled out of this muddy water all over the Earth. These sediments trapped and buried plants and animals, forming the fossil record. The flooding uprooted vegetation, moving it to regions where it accumulated and quickly became coal and oil by processes we can duplicate in the laboratory today. Experiments show that as erosion widened the rupture, its width became so great that the compressed rock beneath the subterranean chamber sprung upward, giving birth to the mid-oceanic ridge that wraps around the Earth like the seam of a baseball. The continental plates, the hydroplates, still with lubricating water beneath them, slid downhill away from the rising mid-Atlantic ridge. After the massive, slowly accelerating continental plates reached speeds of about 45 miles an hour, they ran into resistances, compressed, crushed, thickened, and buckled. Portions of the hydroplates that buckled up formed mountains. Those that buckled down formed ocean trenches. This is why these features are generally parallel to the oceanic ridges from which they slid. The hydroplates, in sliding away from the oceanic ridges, opened up very deep ocean basins into which the floodwaters retreated. Every continental basin was naturally left brimful of water, producing many post-flood lakes. Each lake that grew from rainfall or drainage from higher elevations spilled over its rim at the lowest point of the rim. That eroded a little notch in the rim, allowing even more water to flow through the notch faster, cutting the soft flood-deposited sediments even deeper. This process accelerated until all the lake's water dumped through a very deep slit, forming a canyon. The largest of these was the Grand Canyon. North and east of the Grand Canyon was a huge lake that I have identified and named Grand Lake. Its dumping released more water than is in all five of the Great Lakes combined. Grand Lake spilled over its rim, eroded its dam, 20 miles south of Page, Arizona, catastrophically forming the Grand Canyon within a few weeks.
There. That is Walt Brown's hydroplate theory, which to me makes the most sense of anything I've seen. Explain several things. If the crack would widen around the mid-Atlantic ridge as the water is shooting out, it's going to spread out, allowing the basalt underneath to bulge up, which is precisely what happens. As the basalt bulges up, it's going to get cracks in it, and it's also going to slide the superimposing plates away from them. They're going to slide and run into something else, and it would explain the compressed mountains we see in, for instance, British Columbia, where the mountains are smashed from the end. I mean, the wrinkles go up and down. The mountain was, it's like somebody pushed carpet up against the wall, causing it to wrinkle. I think Christians need to have an answer for those kind of things, and this is one of the possible answers. When the basalt cracked, the water would rush into the crack, cooling it down, and cool rock holds a magnetic field. Hot rock will lose a magnetic field. So when they found what they said were magnetic reversals at the bottom of the ocean floor, they're actually finding the old cracks where the basalt broke, because there were going to be warmer and cooler areas from simply the water rushing in. Those cracks are probably now all full of sediments. So don't let them tell you there are magnetic reversals. There may be a few from the rocks flipping over at the flood, but I think a much better theory is the hydroplate theory.
What you're looking at here is a pair of seismographic images made of the interior of the Earth during the years 2006, 7, and 8. Take a look at the yellow and red areas. These areas are massive amounts of water in saturated rock inside the Earth. Now, when I say saturated, what I mean is they are not freestanding bodies of water. Instead, they are rock, which is fully saturated with water at tremendous depths in the Earth. The more density of water, the darker the color. Yellow means less saturated, red-orange means more saturated, and red means highly saturated. The one which you see at the greatest depth, which wraps around the outer core of the Earth, which is yellow and orange, is called the Beijing Anomaly. This anomaly contains, it is estimated, enough water to fill the Arctic Ocean by itself. Now keep in mind, what you're looking at is a slice of the Earth. These anomalies are three-dimensional. They go around the Earth as well. There's a great volume of water inside the Earth. Before the flood, there was far more water inside the Earth. And all that's left now is water-saturated rock, whereas before the flood, there were freestanding bodies of water inside the Earth, upon which the crust of the Earth was bearing down, which was expelled and caused the flood of Noah, covering the entire Earth. The Bible tells us in Genesis 7, verse 11, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day, were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. These words were written some 1,500 years before Christ. One must wonder how the Bible could have known, 1,500 years before Christ, 2,500 years ago, that the ocean floors had great fountains in them, when it was not until the latter half of the 20th century that man's technology allowed him to explore the ocean floors and discover these fountains. They're called the mid-oceanic ridges, and they run around the earth like the seam of a baseball, and water is still coming forth from them all around the world. The Bible tells us how this water came to be inside the earth. It was there when God created the earth. He created the earth with the water inside of it. The Word of God states, "And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, let the waters under heaven be gathered together in one place, and let dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and gathered together the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good." The waters which were above the firmament, which is the atmosphere of the earth, called the first heaven in the Bible, became an ice crystal canopy which surrounded the earth and protected the earth from the harmful effects of gamma, X-ray, and ultraviolet radiation, which, by the way, when the waters erupted from the earth and passed through the atmosphere, past the stratosphere, they encountered the earth's ice canopy. The waters took with them, because of their tremendous speed, part of the Earth's atmosphere. This warmer air caused a chain reaction which brought the canopy down, and is why there is no more canopy surrounding the Earth. Furthermore, this also caused a partial loss of the Earth's atmosphere. This tremendous column of water, moving at tremendous velocity, dragged part of the Earth's atmosphere into outer space, and the Earth permanently lost a percentage of its atmosphere to outer space. And that is why the fossil record of life demonstrates that life forms were much larger, stronger, and healthier in the past than today. You can look up more information about this by doing a search for megafauna. With the lower atmospheric pressure and loss of oxygen, the atmospheric pressure and oxygen content of the atmosphere of the Earth was considerably reduced. This lower oxygen level and atmospheric pressure caused life forms on the Earth to suffer by becoming smaller, weaker, and dumber. Every living thing in this world is on its way to extinction. It's not evolving. It's becoming extinct because of the loss of the Earth's atmosphere and the canopy, which protected the Earth from the harmful effects of gamma, X-ray, and ultraviolet radiation, which is the single greatest cause of random genetic mutation in living things today. The sun is the greatest cause for the life forms of the Earth to be devolving. There is no evolution occurring. All life forms are devolving and headed for extinction because of the harmful effects of the sun and the loss of atmospheric pressure and oxygen content in the atmosphere due to the flood of Noah. By the way, the legends of Yeti and Bigfoot from around the world are based in reality. There was once a species of ape that stood 8 to 10 feet tall. It was called Gigantopithecus. It is likely extinct now. The reason for the legends is because man actually walked with and witnessed these creatures, just as he did with dinosaurs, which is why, from various tribes of man all around the world, are accurate depictions in sculpture and painting of known species of dinosaurs. But like the dinosaurs, Gigantopithecus has gone extinct because of the change in the Earth's atmosphere due to the flood of Noah, and possibly also because of man's hunting. As a matter of fact, in three locations around the world, man's footprints are found in the same strata as dinosaurs and even crisscrossing each other. This discredits the evolutionists' claim about the age of the strata and proves that man walked with dinosaurs. In fact, the Delk print is a human fossil footprint into which a dinosaur stepped while the material was still soft. It has been scanned in a hospital CT scanner and verified as authentic.